Let's start with the news. Now, as you can see, the headline is the significance of the Supreme Court's recent decision or verdict with respect to protection of children from Sexual Offences Act of 2012. Okay, so there has been a decision which has been recently coming into the picture with respect to skin-to-skin contact that has been there in the POCSO. Now, the Bombay High Court, in very controversial previous two decisions, has said that until and unless there is skin-to-skin contact with respect to one case, we will discuss about that, it will not be counted as a sexual offence under POCSO. And this is what is all wrong with the decision according to the Supreme Court, and because of the backdrop of it, we are going to discuss everything in detail. Now, if we talk about the background is with respect to one case, that is Attorney General for India versus Satish. Now, here the problem was that there was no skin-to-skin contact with respect to the perpetrator of the crime and the victim or the survivor. The 12-year-old survivor, she went with her neighbor, and the neighbor actually you can say lured her inside under the pretext of providing guava. So she went inside, and there, as she was a 12-year-old child, and under the POCSO Act, any child is a person who is below the age of 18 years. And there, an assault occurred. But the assault was such that the pressing of the breasts was such that there was no skin-to-skin contact. And he also tried to ask and force her to remove her knicker. When the victim saw survivor's mother, she went on for looking for her daughter. She asked certain of her neighbors that, where is my daughter? So they told her that the neighbor, one of your neighbors, has took her to his own place. And when she went inside, when she went through the door of the perpetrator, she asked him, and he denied that he does not know the girl. But the door was bolted from outside. She went inside, she found her daughter crying. And when the daughter told her that this happened, this case was then coming into the picture. So, because of no skin-to-skin contact, although the special court, which was established under the POCSO, because of that, it took cognizance of the offense, because of the POCSO Act, it took cognizance and it convicted the perpetrator. But, now, very interestingly, Bombay High Court acquitted him under the POCSO Act, and barely with the help of IPC 354. A very slight conviction was done. And as you can see, special court had convicted the accused for sexual assault. And this is under the POCSO. This is established under the POCSO Act itself. And the Nagpur bench of the Bombay High Court expressed that what? First, stringent punishment for sexual assault warranted stricter proof. So, because of the lack of proof, as there were only two people present inside the room, it was very difficult to prove. First is that, no direct physical contact. Again, because there was no skin-to-skin touch. Remember this, could be your prelims question. There was no skin-to-skin touch. The other thing is respect to that. And with sexual intent, without penetration, as there was no penetration, no actual intercourse, so it couldn't be proved that yes, this comes under the section 7 of the POCSO. Although two acts were there, first is, we will discuss about the acts and sections as well. IPC 354, keep this in mind. And one more under POCSO, section 8. Only these two provisions were cited when we talk about this case. Then let's move forward and talk about the next case, that is State of Maharashtra versus Libnis. Now, a 5-year-old girl was assaulted when the perpetrator tried to show the genitalia. That was because of no penetration itself. Again here, the intent was not very clear. According to the Bombay High Court, the intent was not clear. So, appellants act according to it, when the perpetrator lifted the frock, took down the pants of the girl, and then exposed his genitalia. So, this was not under the ambit of the POCSO. Under, there is also one definition, other offences, among other offences. So, with respect to POCSO, if any person touches the vagina or the penis or touch the breasts and anus, this all comes into the ambit of POCSO. And there is also one more provision that and other such offenses will be cited as sexual offenses. Now, because the acts were not under the other acts, it was not, the person was not convicted. Okay. So, remember, did not fall within the ambit of the other act under section 7. So, remember very clearly that how we have to write an answer when we talk about knowing the facts with respect to certain cases. And he was acquitted for aggravated penetrative sexual act. Aggravated means a potential sexual act. And he was convicted for lesser offenses of sexual harassment under both the POCSO and the IPC. Okay, let's move forward and talk about the POCSO Act. Now, before we talk about the POCSO Act, let's know some facts that India, since the year 2003, is trying to protect its children. Now, in 2003, there was an act with respect to providing protection to children in Goa. So, before POCSO, we had only this act, and that was, of course, applicable only in the state of Goa. And India is also thinking about Article 21, Right to Life and Liberty, right? Article 21 is important. It is given to every citizen that is there in our country. Even foreigners get Article 21 protection. And then, since the year 2012, since last 9 years, India is trying to protect its children with respect to sexual harassment, sexual offenses, and provide welfare to them. And if we talk about this, enacted to protect children, sexual assault, harassment and pornography, and due regard for the safeguarding of interest and well-being of children. And it was amended in the year 2019 when death penalty, more stringent punishments were also included. The aim was to provide more stringent penalties, provide more protection. So there is still a gap with respect to the highest minimum punishment under the POCSO Act and if the crimes are balancing it out. We will talk about that as well. So death penalty is actually in the civilized societies, still many people are against it. Remember this. Now it also defines a child as any person below the age of 18 years. As you can see, this is a neutral act. This is not a gender biased act. We are not talking about only women because small men, small babies, small boys are also abused. So, it's a gender neutral act. Also, if we talk about its insurance, it ensures that healthy physical, emotional and intellectual as well as social development of a child occurs and a child will only occur when there is no fear. It deems a sexual assault to be aggravated. Aggravated means escalated, much more heinous. When a person or a child, not a person, a child below the age of 18 years is abused, when the child is mentally ill or the abuse is committed by somebody who holds the position of trust, that means family members or close friends of the parents. So these all hold a position of trust. And here also, the crime will be aggravated in nature if it is occurring. Also, police officers, teachers, doctors, family members, if all these are perpetrators with respect to child abuse, this is also a category of aggravated child abuse. Police officers are actually given a post of the protector of children throughout the investigation with respect to the POCSO Act. And the disposal of case should happen within 1 year. Remember this? From the date of the offense reported. Whenever the report is going to occur, within the time of 1 year, this case should be disposed of. Pendency should not be there. And section 7, here, pay attention with respect to this section. Section 7 of the Protection of Children from Sexual Offenses Act of 2012, punishable with a minimum of 3 years, any offense if it occurs. And it can be extended to 5 years with a fine. So, the range is 3 to 5. Aggravated penetrative sexual assault, that means whenever the intercourse is going to occur, includes assault of a child below the age of 12 years, punishable with a minimum of 5 years, which can be extended up to 7 years and a fine. Okay, remember this as well. Moving on, let's talk about what is the stand of the Supreme Court. Now, the Supreme Court has come into the picture thinking about how restrictive the definition has been made by the Bombay High Court. So, this bench consisted of Justice Uday Umesh Lalit, Justice S. Ravindra Bhatt and Justice Bela M. Trivedi. They all talked about how we are going to interpret the definition and expand the ambit. So, Justice Bela Trivedi and Justice S. Ravindra Bhatt have considered that the legislative intent of enforcing child's right to protect from sexual abuse and exploitation. Legislative intent means whenever the law was made, what was the reason and what was the intention behind it? Did the makers of the legislation think about the definition or they think about the final intent, that is protecting the child? Not what has been committed, but what is the result of the commitment of the crime. So, first is that. It rejected the High Court's restrictive interpretation of sexual assault, as it said that only skin-to-skin contact is going to be considered. Other than that, nothing else will be. So, if any kind of assault happens and the touch is through some objects, such as gloves, maybe the perpetrator will wear some material, so that skin-to-skin contact doesn't occur, what will be about that? Will that be considered an assault or not? Right? And objectives of the POCSO Act are advanced and not abused. Just restricting the definition defeats the entire purpose, because crime can be upgraded, and similarly, the law should also be upgraded. Justice Trivedi eschewed a narrow interpretation, again, expand the ambit, and of the terms touch and physical contact, because these are used interchangeably. Moving on, more to be said, restricting touch and physical contact only skin to skin contact would be contrary to the legislative intent. We have talked about that. It leads to absurd situations when touching of children with other material. This we have discussed. And the rule which required the courts to give the accused the benefit in case of statutory ambiguity would not arise, as there were no ambiguity in Section 7. Now, the perpetrators might get the benefit of the doubt and the benefit of a not clear-cut definition under the Section 7. But it is the duty of the courts to understand what can be coming under the ambit of the Section 7 when we talk about the legislative intent and what can't be. And restrictive definition is never a cup of tea of the judiciary. So, Justice Bhatt was of the view that the term physical contact needs to be wider than touch. Okay? Not just touch, but any sort of physical direct or indirect contact can be also taken in. And if we talk about this, sometimes if a victim will be forced to tear off their own clothes, what about that? That is also an indirect kind of touch, indirect sexual assault. And victims, we have discussed that, and the emphasis of the Section 7 is to address the felt social need. The felt social need that we protect our children, we give them the kind of environment they need to fully develop, and for outlawing the behavior driven by sexual intent. Now, this was said that any behavior which has the intention to sexually harm, harass or assault a child, that should be pointed at, and not what is the result, what is the physical result of it. Okay? And High Court's reasoning is, in what did the High Court actually say, the Bombay High Court? The Supreme Court said that they insensitively trivialized the fact. They did not take into the picture the mindset of the perpetrator and the victim slash survivor and the mother. They did not take that into the picture, what was going through the minds of them. So, trivializing the situation because there was not a lot of evidence present, and it legitimizes an entire range of unacceptable behavior. That means, after trivializing, what happened? Now, the perpetrators, potential perpetrators, might get an idea that if they will walk through a road which does not define the definition, which does not matches the definition under Section 7 of POCSO, they can actually bypass the road and find loopholes. and it undermines the child's dignity, autonomy through unwanted intrusions. Okay, let's move forward and talk about the impacts. First of all, the Supreme Court has done it right by expanding and interpreting the intent, the legislative intent of Section 7. And first that we need to understand over here, that I also described before, that the highest minimum punishment, sometimes it is felt that it is of 3 years. Okay, 3 years punishment might not match the intensity of the crime that has been committed. POCSO has said, okay, if any sexual assault happens, the minimum punishment is 3 years. There is no proportionality according to some verdicts, that a person who is committing a crime with respect to sexual assault of lesser intensity should get same amount of punishment to a person who is committing a higher amount of intensity of crime. So that needs more policy research. Proportionality of the punishment should be discussed. This is what the Supreme Court has said. So more research in the field of child abuse can happen with respect to this decision. More and more wider definition can be made with respect to how a child can be emotionally, sexually, actually engaging into different sorts of assaults. How perpetrators can choose loopholes in the definition, and why the government and the NGOs and everybody, people of the society, should come together to understand and aware, get aware and make aware their children about the different sorts of assault. Okay, constant dynamism in the interpretation keeps up with the multifarious malicious intent. As this is a becoming a globalized and digitized world, more and more inventions will also be made in the dark world. So we need to understand that constantly the dark world should be balanced out with the correct white judiciary, with the correct amount of interpretation of whatever is happening into the world. Because there is not one but various ways to torture a child. It could be through cyberbully as well, about which POCSO doesn't talk about. So that is something that we need to understand over here. Let's move on and talk about the challenges. First is delayed reporting. This is a fundamental challenge. People do not come forward to generally report such things because they have a false sense of providing security to their own family. And also sometimes they are ashamed to come forward and report such things. There is lack of evidence, so that acquittals are very high. Not many get convicted. Less than 5% chance of gathering direct physical and medical evidence in such cases, and it takes a toll on the minds of the children. According to the census of 2011, we have 472 million children to protect. And lack of procedural guidance. POCSO has set some standards, but how to guide the entire procedure is absent. That is also another problem. Detailed guidelines on prosecuting cases of child sexual abuse is also absent. That is another challenge. Let's move on and talk about certain other challenges which are with respect to the Act. Those were fundamental. Now this is with respect to the Act. Very low, abysmal means very low rate of conviction. 14% in 2014. 18% in 2017, and according to an NCRB report of 2016, only 29% convictions occurred. 89% pendency is there. Also, many states have not even established special children courts, which is mandated by the POCSO. Again, if the states will not protect their own children with respect to certain provisions, not giving implementation to certain provisions, the future is dark. And one more thing is that happens because of the exploitation. This example is of exploitation of children in orphanages in the state of Tamil Nadu versus Union of India and other cases. This is for your mains examination. Third is that the Act provides a minimum punishment of death penalty. Okay, minimum punishment of death penalty with respect to the sexual offenses under the sexual penetrative offenses under the age of 12 years, for that has been with respect to the victims who are not 12 years or above. So remember that proportionality is also very important. Let's move on and talk about the other challenges with respect to death penalty. that is Justice J.S. Verma committee, and also the 262nd report of the Law Commission of India 2015 was not in favor of death penalty. Also, Section 8 of the POXO Act prescribes a mandatory minimum sentence of 3 years. What is the proportionality? Again, the same thing that I told you, that the crime committed doesn't match the intensity of the punishment. The state of Jammu Kashmir and Vinay Nanda case cannot prescribe punishment lesser than minimum prescribed punishment. So, rigidity is there. Policy matter needs to be worked out. Let's move forward and talk about acquittals. Very low. Because of the high minimum punishment, the acquittal is not as much as the judges think that this is too much. For just one kind of crime, we cannot impose 3 years of sentences. This is what the minds of the judges go through. Okay? Punishing the person under Section 354 of the IPC occurs. If they cannot give death penalty, they will certainly move on to other provisions such as IPC 354. But there is a challenge with IPC 354. This is outraging a woman's modesty. And this does not talk about small boys. Okay? Children who are boys. They are not talking about that. It is victim-oriented statute. That means what the victim has been given as a status under the POXO, the perpetrator is already accused according to the POXO Act itself. It says that this is the victim, and this is even before the person has been proven guilty, the person is actually the perpetrator or the guilty. So it's not unbiased. Okay, the Act does not cover all the aspects of sexual violence of children, that is cyberbullying and other sort of torture with respect to using other materials. Okay, let's move on and talk about the importance of Section 8 of POXO Act and Section 354 of IPC. So, this section of Section 8, right? Section 8 of POXO Act is gender neutral, and punishment can be minimum sentence of 3 years and may extend up to 5 years. And Section 354 of IPC is only for women and not male or transgender children. Okay? And punishment shall not be less than 1 year, but it may extend up to 5 years. So, important for you to understand. Let's move forward and talk about the way forward. We have to overcome the challenges with respect to removing the mandatory minimum sentence and the death penalty. So, policy should be framed out in a manner that the clauses with respect to punishment are gone through well, and it matches the intensity of the crime committed. It should also include offenses such as cyberbullying of children and other online sexual crimes against children. And High Court should also instruct the trial courts to not grant unnecessary adjournments so that pendency doesn't occur. The entire investigation process is already very delayed. If the justice delivery mechanism will also be delayed, then this will embolden other perpetrators of sexual violence against children. And state police chiefs should constitute special task force in order to have more devoted energy towards such cases. And the Supreme Court issued a directive to set up special court within 60 days, and this should be implemented in each state so that pendency doesn't occur and justice shouldn't be delayed. Introduction of sex education in school, as according to a parliamentary report, was also given an acknowledgement in 2008 and 9, but it has not been implemented. If we are going to normalize sex ed in schools, it will give a lot of boost to addressing the curiosity of the children. If they will not get addressed, the children will resort to some other malicious means to get the answers of their questions. So we have to normalize this in the society as well. Awareness and sensitization of people is equally important to prevent the crime itself, because it's going to be a teamwork eventually. Now, let's move on to our mains-based question. Critically analyze the Protection of Children from Sexual Offences Act. Also, suggest amendments with regard to the recent judgment of the Supreme Court over the interpretation of skin-to-skin contact in 250 words. Okay, so that's it for today. Tomorrow, we shall meet again with another segment. Until then, stay updated. And thank you so much for watching.